Ephesians chapter 6, verse number, we're down to verse number 12. Verse number 10, he says, "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places." Let's pray. Father, we thank you this morning for the opportunity to meet together and study your word. We thank you that we have the word of God in our hands, that we can trust it, believe it, and as we understand it, obey it. And we pray that what we do this morning might be for the edification of your people and the clarity of the gospel for those that need to be saved, and that it all honor our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, in his name we pray. Amen. Now, Paul here is ending the book, this great book. You know, this is the 287th lesson in Ephesians. Now, I don't know how long that is. That's a long time. And soon we'll be, soon, maybe another year or two, we'll be through with the book. And we take our time. We're not just studying, just to study the verses. We're taking excursions. Donald Gray Barnhouse used to say that he taught the book of Romans, and what he did is he taught Bible doctrine using the book of Romans as a point of departure. And that's sort of what we do as we study through these books. But when you come to the end, when Paul comes to the end of the book and he says, "Finally, my brethren," after he's discussed the conflict, the calling that we have in Christ, and then the conduct that calling presents. In other words, here we have this identity in Christ, and then it presents itself in the life of a believer. The result of that is going to be a conflict. So your calling and your conduct produces the conflict. The blessings and the behavior that comes from it produces the battle. And this conflict is with the adversary, the devil. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil, the adversary. It's a conflict in the invisible realm. Verse 12, we wrestle not against flesh and blood. It's not a physical kind of a wrestling, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. What we're fighting is a battle against spiritual wickedness, spiritual activities. It's a real battle. Sometimes when you can't see it or feel it or touch it, and your emotions can't respond to it that way, you don't think it's real. But there's a real spirit world, and there's a real conflict and battle and struggle, hand-to-hand combat wrestling is, that's there. And it's important to understand that. We've been talking about the adversary, Satan. Verse 12 is talking about his cohorts. The battle with Satan is not just against the person of Satan. I've often wondered, I wonder if Satan actually knows my name. I doubt it. We say, well, the devil did that. You remember Flip Wilson said, the devil made me do it? I doubt the devil knows any of us personally, but he has a whole cadre of cohorts, sort of like a satanic mafia that fills up the universe. And when you cause enough trouble, you get a little attention over here, and then the news goes up the line. I don't know how far up the organizational line we go, but I'm sure we go, a little bit. 2 Corinthians 6 is a verse that's always been a comfort to me. He says, as unknown and yet well known. We look like, because we're a small group of people, numerically, humanly speaking, we look like you're pretty unknown. Where do you think we're going to show up in church history? Have you ever read church history books looking for people that like you? You know where they are? Well, they aren't there in most church history books, because most church history books are either written by Roman Catholics or Roman Catholic sympathizing Protestants, and they don't recognize Bible-believing people at all unless they call them heretics. You can find a few books that written by some of our cadre that have some of us in it, but you and I aren't going to show up in the history books. We're going to be unknown to history, and yet we're really well known, because your spiritual impact far exceeds your physical impact, your physical presence. You need to remember that in your life. In your life and in your family and in your job and in your neighborhood, your spiritual impact goes out much farther than anything you realize or you're aware of. So when you stand for the truth and you live with the treasure in your life that Christ is, and you value him and treasure him, and it's clear that the way you live your life, the decisions you make in your life, the things that fill up your life, are come out of an appreciation for him and his word above everything else, that has an impact. The current culture is not such a great impact. It's not, I shouldn't say it's not a great impact. It's sort of a negative impact. Preachers say, we want to get results. And I always think, Stephen got results. You know what happened to Stephen? Yeah, they went and did a Mike Tyson on him, and then they stoned him. That's not, you remember that, right? They didn't chew off an ear, but they tried to chew off a leg. And then they stoned him. But that was results, okay? So sometimes the results aren't real positive, but that's okay. He preached the truth, and then you get what you get. So it's important to understand some things about the adversary. And I want you to be clear, in that verse, when he talks about principalities, powers, the rulers of the darkness of this world, spiritual wickedness in high places, he's talking about the cohorts that Satan has. So I'll just back up a minute and talk about that. Come with me to Luke chapter number 11. Satan has a whole group of creatures, beings in the spirit world that work with him, that are a part of his cadre, that are part of his mafia, if you want to call it that. You know, if you live in Illinois or you live in New Jersey, you're real familiar with the mafia. Most everybody else is familiar with it by the TV. But Satan has that kind of a thing. And Satan understands what God is doing. Nobody else might, but he knows. And he fights God's working at the point that God is working. He isn't fighting something God used to do. He's not trying to keep anybody from building a boat. You with me? The ark. He's not trying to get anybody to stop offering animal sacrifices. Okay? But he is, because he knows God did that, but that isn't what God's doing today. So he fights the adversary. The adversary fights God's program at the point in which God is operating. In Luke chapter 11, I'm going to use an illustration. Christ's earthly ministry was the special object of the adversary's opposition. Notice how it happens. Luke chapter 11, verse 18. Jesus is talking to some people here, and he says, if Satan also is divided against himself, how shall his kingdom stand? Because you say that I cast out devils through Beelzebub, and if I by Beelzebub cast out devils, Beelzebub means the Lord of the flies. Beelzebub is superfly. And if I'm casting out devils, Jesus says, by the power of Satan, then his kingdom is divided against itself. Notice, Satan has a kingdom that's fighting against the kingdom of God. This is bigger than just, I don't like you, I'm going to come get you. There's a whole corporate activity going on here. Verse 19, if I by Beelzebub cast out devils, by whom do your sons cast them out? Whew. Therefore shall they be your judges. But if I by the finger of God cast out devils, no doubt the kingdom of God is come unto you. Notice there's two kingdoms. There's Satan's kingdom, there's God's kingdom. And just like God's kingdom has cohorts, Satan's kingdom has them. Verse 21. When a strong man, that's who Satan is. By that verse, if you write down Jeremiah 31:11, you'll see that Jeremiah talks about Israel, that there's there's one stronger than them that's got him in his grip and he's holding them. And they can't get away from him. They're in his bondage. Talk about the adversary. If the strong man is holding Satan is holding Israel, if the strong man, watch, armed. He's got armament. He's got weapons. Keepeth his palace. The guy's got a stronghold. He's got a place he's controlling and holding. He's got territory. His goods are in peace. So he's come in, we'll say in this case, he's come in and he's taken over the land of Israel, and he's holding the land of Israel by holding Israel in a strong grip of captivity. That's what Christ's talking about. He's in there casting out devils. Well, those devils are possessing the nation Israel so that God can't use Israel to reclaim the land. Now, verse 22, when a stronger than he, that's Christ, shall come unto him and overtake him, overcome him, he taketh from him all his armor, wherein he trusted, and divideth his spoils. I just want you to see the terminology there. There's a kingdom that Satan has. He's got territory that he's possessing. He's got armor. He's got armies. He's got an armed group of people. And he's got a bunch of stuff he doesn't want to give up. Now, in the earthly ministry of Christ, that was talking about Israel and Satan's possessing them. What I want you to see there is that Satan, this stuff's real. And it's talking about and is focused on what God was doing. Christ has come. He's come back to call out a believing remnant in Israel. And Satan's opposing what God's doing there. And the opposition is a real opposition. And the warfare was over the dominion over the earth that God's promised to accomplish through the nation Israel. Now, when you come to Ephesians 6, it's the same principle. It's just a different arena. Because today, God isn't trying to reclaim the earth. He's not forming the nation Israel. He's set that program aside temporarily. And he's today forming a spiritual body of believers called the church, the body of Christ. God is not trying to reclaim real estate today. That's something to remember. He's forming a spiritual body of people. That's why the verse says we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against, and then he talks about principalities, powers, the rulers of darkness, spiritual wickedness. So there are some spiritual rulers that Satan has in control of his kingdom, and they work with him. And it's an invisible kind of a realm, but it's real. I've said to you, when you study these things, if you understand four things, number one, these positions are real, because we tend to, you know, think it's spiritualized and it's just kind of esoterical. No, these are real things, real beings, real positions. Two, they're organized, principalities and powers, rulers. There's an organization structure in them. Number three, they've been usurped by the adversary. And number four, God's got a reconciliation plan. And we've talked about that many times. I just want to spend a little time talking about Satan's crowd. Come with me, if you will, to Colossians chapter 1. Let's just start a place where we're real familiar. You get Colossians chapter 1 and Amos chapter number 9. These are two verses that, one in Paul's epistles, one in the prophets, that give you a quick overview. Now, by the way, we studied these things many times, and I spent an hour last Sunday, Sunday night week ago, talking about the physical structure of the universe as it's laid out in the Bible. There's a lot of details that you can understand about these things, but there's some fundamental things that you need to grasp. We can discuss some of the other things, you know, whether it's one way or another, but these fundamental things are things you need to understand, have to fit any model that you use. Colossians chapter 1, verse 16, talking about Jesus Christ. For by him were all things created. Okay, there goes the monkey, there goes evolution, that's all out the door. In the beginning, God created. Okay, that's all you got to get. But when he did that, notice how he did it. By him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth. Now we're back in Genesis 1:1. Visible and invisible. So there's some creation that you can see here on the earth. It's here. It's visible. Then there's some in the heavens. You can't see them. Whether they be thrones, dominions, principalities and powers. Now, those are positions of governmental authority. That's why chapter 6, verse 12, we just read, he starts out with principalities and powers. Those are the positions of government. Amos chapter 9, hold on to Colossians, verse number 5, speaking about the Lord's return to the earth to reclaim the universe, really. Amos 9, verse 5, and the Lord God of hosts is he that toucheth the land, and it shall melt. This is the second coming. And all that dwell therein shall mourn, and it shall rise up wholly like a flood, and shall be drowned as by the flood of Egypt. It is he, here's the one coming back, that buildeth his stories in the heaven, and hath founded his troop in the earth. Notice, he built his stories in the heavens. When he says heaven, stories there, he's not talking about like I tell you a story or we write a TV story. He's talking about what you go down to the Sears Tower and you go up on the 103rd story. So he's talking about the layers. And when he built the heavens, he built layers of authority, activity. Now, they're not physical. They're spiritual. They're not visible. They're invisible. But when he structured the universe, Job talks about the ordinances of heaven. He talks about the structure that God placed in the organization of the heavens. So there's the principalities, the powers, and so forth. These are positions. Come with me to Romans chapter 8. It's important to understand that these are positions occupied by creatures. Romans chapter 8, verse 38. Romans 8, 38. For I am persuaded, Paul says, that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor any other, nor things present, nor things to come, neither height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus. Notice how he says, I'm persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers. Angels are creatures. So you have angels, and then you have principalities. Well, if that's an angel and a principality, it's not an angel. There's an angel and a power, then a power is not an angel. The principalities and powers are positions. The angels are creatures that occupy the positions. You follow that? So it's important to understand that when we talk about an angel, what position does the angel occupy? In other words, what's his job? Well, the jobs are principalities, powers, mights, dominions, thrones, and so forth. So you have a description in Ephesians first of the principalities of the positions. Now, if you go back with me to Ephesians chapter 1, Paul has already told us in Ephesians 1 about these things. Ephesians 1, verse 21. The Lord Jesus Christ was raised from the dead, then he ascended up and sat at the Father's right hand, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named. Notice how if you go through Paul's epistles, you'll find six or eight of these terms. They start off principality. Now, principality is the top ruler. So if he's going to be the top ruler, Ephesians already told you who the rulers are. They're the rulers of the darkness of this world. There are some creatures that occupy this government who are the rulers of the darkness of this world. Now that term darkness, come over to Colossians chapter 1. That term darkness is a term of art in the Bible that describes really the name of the kingdom of the adversary. Colossians 1 verse 13. Verse 12, Colossians 1:12, giving thanks unto the Father, who hath made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light, who hath delivered us from the power of darkness, and hath translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son. There you are under the control and under the power of darkness. The rulers of the darkness of this world controlled you, held you captive because of Calvary, verse 14, in whom we have redemption through his blood. Because of the cross work of Jesus Christ and the invisible spiritual warfare that Christ took place on the cross. We're going to talk about that in our next session. Because of that, him winning that warfare, he won the right to take you out of the kingdom of darkness and put you into the kingdom of light. Take you out from under the control of the rulers of the darkness of this world. Now think about the darkness of this world. I go back in my mind to Romans chapter 1, where I take you, it seems like every Sunday lately. And he talks about professing themselves to be wise. They became fools. And the foolish heart was darkened. The answer is thy word is light. When you turn out the light, you have darkness. The power, the authority of those who have rejected the light and live in darkness. The rulers of the darkness, the don't want to attain God of their knowledge crowd. Don't do it God's way. Not going to submit to the Creator. The rulers of that, he's taken you, he won the right at Calvary. You know, there's a great old song. You have to come from down south to have heard it probably, but it says, because of Calvary, we don't live here anymore. You ever heard that? Yeah. Old Younts used to sing that. And that's a great thing. Every time I hear that song, I think of old brother Fred Triplett in Mobile. When I used to work at the mission as a kid, when you're 70, you think you were a kid when you were 20. You 20-year-olds think your kid's a 10-year-old, but you're still a kid. And Brother Triplett was a terrible drunk. His family used to bring him to the mission and throw him out on the street, and he'd get drunk at home, throw him out on the curb. Brother Reynolds used to say, why you bring him down here if you can't? You don't want him. Why do you think we want him when he's drunk? You know, he's okay to go home when he's not drunk, but... And one night he got saved. And every time we have a testimony, Brother Fred would get up. And he said, I want you to know that the night after I got saved, when I went home that night, even the cat knew I was different. He said, I'd go home, and every night I'd go home, I'd kick the cat right off the porch. And that night I didn't kick the cat. He ran from me, but I didn't kick him. And it says, because of Calvary, I'm different. I'm not the man I used to be. And it's the cross work of Jesus Christ that sets you free. Amen. But one of the things it did, it didn't just forgive your sins, it didn't just give you redemption, it took you out from under the authority of the rulers of darkness and put you into the kingdom of light. Amen. Whoa. My point to you is the rulers of the darkness of this world are real. This isn't just a philosophy session you're fighting. Listen, your family, your children, you are under an assault that wants to say, we don't want to retain God in our knowledge. The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. That is, they're not just saying there's no God existing. They're saying, I don't want God in messing in my life. Their foolish heart is darkened. And you need to understand, this stuff's real. Now, go back to verse 12. I'm get to preaching instead of teaching here. Notice that the rulers of the darkness of this world, notice he calls them spiritual wickedness in high places. That's who the rulers of the darkness of this world are, and that's what they're propagating. You remember chapter 1, verse 3 says, Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who's blessed us with all spiritual blessings. You think spiritual wickedness might be the opposite of that? No. You and I live in the possession and the reality of being blessed with all spiritual blessings. This crowd lives under the control and authority of spiritual wickedness. You've been transferred from that
to that. I mean, hallelujah. Now, so there's the rulers that are propagating spiritual wickedness. And by the way, when it says high places, he's not talking about like high up in the echelon of the earthly government. That's a reference to the heavenly places. And I'll show you that in a little while. Principalities. Principality is a top ruler, the top echelon of the angelic realm. You have what are called archangels. Michael is an archangel. Gabriel is an archangel. In fact, they're the only two that stayed with God when the rebellion came. But an archangel, he's the top echelon. So the heavens are divided. Actually, the heavens and the earth are divided 12 and 12. 12 regions, 12 on the earth, 12 up there. That's why the 24 elders in Revelation 4. And each of those realms has a top ruler. So the principalities are top rulers. Then it talks about powers. You remember the verse, the powers that be are ordained of God. A power, and then it talks about mights. There's two ways to think about power. One is the policeman says he has authority from the court. He's an officer of the court. He has the power, the authority of the court, arrest power. He can detain you, do it legally. Because as an officer of the court, he has delegated authority. That's a power. So there is a whole echelon of rulers who are commissioned to represent the government in the heavens, in that realm, and they're commissioned to go and carry out the business. Then you have mights. The word might is the idea, it's power in the sense of I've got the ability to pick it up. You know the difference between may and can? You may do it, but can you? You know, do you have the oomph to do it? Well, do you have the oomph to do it? Somebody's doing a transcript, how are they going to spell oomph? I'm not sure. You worry about that. Do you have the ability to do it? So you have mites. In other words, you have a whole cadre of in the army that are able to enforce. That's why it's called an army. It's like a police force. If you get a judgment from the court, and the court says, you have to pay this judgment, you have to go to the sheriff to get the thing enforced. Because a court can only say something, give you the authority, but they have no enforcement. That's what the sheriff does. You follow that? So when he talks about mights, he's talking about there's this enforcement group. Then he talks about thrones. You remember Jesus told his apostles, you're going to sit upon 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. A throne is a regional kind of ruler over a particular area. There are going to be 12 thrones over the nation Israel, divided into 12 sections, and each has a throne that's over that particular area. Then it talks about dominions. That's a subdivision underneath the throne. You remember in Luke chapter 19, I'm not going to read all these verses because I don't want to get bogged down in it. And if I start looking at them, we'll be here next week still talking. But Luke 19, Jesus told the parable about the guy that leaves, goes away to get his kingdom and to return. And when he left, he took his goods and left them in the hands of his stewards. And he gave one 10 pounds, one 5, one 1-1, you remember the story. And when he came back, he calls them in to be accountable. And then he says, you've been faithful over 10 things. I'm going to give you rulership over 10 cities. You've been faithful over 5. I'll give you ruler over 5 cities. That's the dominion kind of thing. It's the smaller kind of thing. Here you got one guy over everything. Then you've got some. In other words, the government just goes right down to the small print. And then it's got the every name that's named. I love that one. Who are you? I'm one of the every name that's named. get my name tag. What am I? You know. That's just the rank and file. That's the ordinary creatures and the rank and file angelic realm. You have angels. That's angels are more or less just the average kind of guy. There are some special ones, but most of them are just ordinary dudes carrying on ordinary tasks. So in the government, there's a clear delineation of principalities, powers that go out and carry out execute the will and the authority, mights who make sure things are done the way they need to be done, and then you have the thrones, dominions, and so forth. And then you have the whole cadre of the host, when you read about the heavenly host kind of thing. Now, all of these positions are occupied by spirit beings. Come with me to Hebrews chapter 1. Generally, we call them angels. Now, you know there are other kind of angels. If you want to say the different races of angels, categories of angels, I don't care how you delineate it. People do it different ways. There are cherubim, there are seraphim, there are living creatures around the throne, there are the seven spirits, capital S, there's their name, there are unclean spirits and so forth. Hebrews chapter 1, verse 14, he's talking about angels, and he said, are they not all ministering spirits sent forth to minister for them who are heirs of salvation? In Israel's program, the angels ministered to them in special ways. My point to you is that angels are spirits. They're not made of flesh, although they can materialize and work in an earthly scene. But they are spirit beings. Their essence is that of a spirit. And so you have angels, you have cherubim, you have seraphim. You remember those things, Isaiah 6. And you have living creatures before the throne, Ezekiel 1, Revelation 4. So you have a whole cadre of different creatures who fill up these positions. So you have the positions, then you have these living creatures that occupy those positions. And by the way, when the Bible talks about unclean spirits, an unclean spirit is a fallen angel. We talk about them being disembodied. You remember in the earthly ministry of Christ, we're going to study Mark chapter 5 Wednesday night, and there's a man who's got all these demons that are in him, and Christ is going to cast them out of him. And they're literally disembodied. They don't have the body that they had originally as a spirit. They've left that habitation, Jude says. And so you have, now that took place at the flood, and there's a bunch of stuff about where it came from, but you've got these things running around. That's why Ephesians chapter 2, in Ephesians 2, verse 2, Ephesians 2, verse 1, and you hath he quickened, who were dead in trespasses and sins, wherein in time past you walked, according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, that's Satan, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience. Notice these spirits work in the children of disobedience. They carry on the course of this world. Do you understand, folks, that unsaved people, the creative genius of unsaved people is satanically inspired? The world out there is under the control and the power and the authority and the possession of a spiritual wickedness propagated by these spirit beings, and it controls it. And it runs the court, and it uses your flesh, their flesh, to do that. Now, where do all these things come from? Come with me to Revelation chapter 12 in one hand, and Ezekiel chapter 28. So you've got all these different creatures, and I'm not trying to confuse you, but I'm also not trying to spend all, you know, all summer, which I guess now it's over with. Every one of these things I'm talking about, you could spend an hour discussing and trying to figure it all out. But you have all these, this spiritual wickedness that's operated by these cohorts of the adversary. And if you, what to get out of this is that he's not working by himself. He's got this whole army of combatants that work in the spiritual realm. God today is forming a spiritual body of believers. That's where the conflict is.
Ezekiel 28.
In Revelation chapter 12. In Revelation 12, there's a passage that gets misunderstood, just like Ezekiel 28 and Isaiah 14. In Revelation 12, you're looking at a passage that describes some events during the middle of the 70th week of Daniel, which is future from where we are today. Okay? This is a future event. Verse 3. And there appeared another wonder in heaven, and behold, a great red dragon, having 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 crowns on his head. Now who is the dragon? Verse 9. The great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan. So who is, in verse 3, who is the dragon? Satan, the devil. And his tail drew a third part of the stars of heaven and did cast them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman, which is Israel, which was ready to be delivered for to devour her child as soon as it was born. Now that verse is not talking about something that happened in time way in the past. That verse is talking about, if you look down, I'll close my Bible, if you look down at verse number 7, there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels. So that third part of the stars of heaven, that's his angels. So Satan's mafia is populated by a third of the angelic host. Now you understand there are tens of millions of angels. 1,000 times 10,000, Psalms talks about. A third of them are in Satan's camp. And in the middle of the 70th week, Michael comes. There's a battle in heaven between Michael and his angels. That's the elect angels, God's team. And the dragon, his angels. And Satan's angels prevail not, neither was their place, their principalities, powers, mights, dominion, their position, found any more in heaven. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceived the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. And I heard a loud voice saying, in heaven, now in heaven is come salvation and strength, the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ, the accuser of the brethren cast down. Christ comes back into the heavens, throws Satan out, all of his cadres that are in the positions of government of the heavens, throws them down to the earth, does what Numbers 33 says that Israel will do. He dispossesses them, and then he puts you and me as members of the body of Christ in those positions of governmental authority. And in the heaven, in the middle of the 7th week, the kingdom of God is established in the heavens, and you and I are part of that. That's what he talks about there in Colossians 1, verse 11, about giving us, making us partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light. He uses us to inherit, take possession of the heavenly places. That's your goal. That's your destiny, is to be in those positions after Satan's guys are cast out. Now, a third of those positions are held by the adversary. And that's what verse 3 is talking about, and verse 4. Now, what people do with this passage is they say, well, that means back at the original beginning, a third fell. But that passage isn't talking about that. That passage is talking about what's going to happen in the future. But, you remember I told you in Isaiah 14, that was what happens over here, but it's referring back to what he said back here. Ezekiel 28 takes place at the second advent, the tribulation, but it's describing what happened way back over here. Well, look, if he takes a third with him over here, where'd that third come from? They didn't make the decision over here in the middle of the seventh week to become Satan and his angels. That was a decision that they made back over here at the beginning. So when people misplace, and when you misplace the stuff in Revelation and you take it out of the future, then you think that man-child is the birth of Christ, and you think that the woman, which is Israel, is the church, and so forth, and you just get, now you just kicked out Bible study and just became a hallucinogenic. And that's where the amillennialism, that's where Romanism comes from, all the rest of it. So this is real but the thing is, those third out there, where'd they come from? Well, here they are, Ezekiel 28. Now, we've studied down to verse 15 quite thoroughly. Verse 15, thou, that's the anointed cherub that covered, that's Satan, the guy who became, that's Lucifer. Thou was perfect in thy ways from the day that thou was created till iniquity was found in thee. So there came a point where Lucifer became Satan. He did it by making a choice to rebel against God's authority. We studied that. He developed spiritual wickedness in high places. Verse 16, by the multitude of thy merchandise, thou hast filled the midst of thee with violence, and thou hast sinned. Therefore I will cast thee as profane out of the mountain of God, and I will destroy thee, O covering cherub. Notice, he's got some merchandise. What do you do with merchandise? They got mums out front out there. That's merchandise. What do they want you to do? Buy it. Satan had a plan that he goes out and he sells. Verse number 18, thou hast defiled thy sanctuaries. Remember that verse over there in Luke talks about his palaces? Thou hast defiled thy sanctuaries by the multitude of thine iniquities, by the iniquity of thy traffic. Therefore will I bring forth fire and so on and so forth. God's judgment was because he wasn't just because he sinned, but he went out and got a bunch of followers. Now, by the way, he started at the top. Brother Oscar Woodall used to talk about, he said, he was metropolitan insurance agent for a number of years. He said, I'll sell insurance to the president of the company or the janitor, either. But he says it's more profitable to sell it to the president, because if you sell it to the president, what's the vice president going to do? Probably buy it. You sell it to the janitor, the president won't talk to you. So you start at the top and work your way down. Why don't sell it to everybody? And when he does that, in that upper echelon of the angelic creation, he struck pay dirt. That's why when Gabriel talks in Daniel 10, he says, only Michael holds with me. Only Michael and Gabriel stayed true. So the third part that fall, they fall back here. Now, they don't get cast out till the middle of the seventh week. But they start back here with the adversary when he sells them their goods. And that spiritual wickedness begins back there with the propagating. So, it's important to understand that Satan has all this crowd that works with him, these cohorts, and their goal is to propagate their system. Now, why do they do that? Come with me. Why do they want to fight you and me so hard? Well, come over to Colossians chapter 2 and Ephesians chapter 3. Colossians 2 and Ephesians 3. Because it's important to understand why they're going to fight. Why this crowd is motivated. Colossians 2 verse 15, talking about the cross. You see verse 14, he nailed the law to his cross. Colossians 2 15, having spoiled principalities and powers. What do? He went in and took away from them their authority, their right to those positions. Having spoiled principalities and powers. That's that verse in Luke. I read it earlier, the comparison. They went and spoiled it. Christ literally won the right at Calvary to take the possessions of spiritual wickedness away from them. and made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in the cross. He didn't just take away their stuff and their right to possess things. He made fools of them. He made a show of them. He held them up to public ridicule. You know the verse in 1 Corinthians chapter 2. We speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom, which none of the princes of this world, none of that top echelon guys could understand. If they had, they wouldn't have crucified the Lord of glory. All God had to do to take all of that crowd who were professing to be wise, all he had to do was keep a secret. And it caused them to do the very thing that is their undoing, the cross work. And they crucified. Had they been able to figure it out? And what they boasted in their wisdom. Satan, I've tried to show you all along, his boast was in his wisdom. The beauty of his wisdom is what he was selling. And the cross, but that information is revealed in the secret. We speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom. Can you understand why Satan and his influence doesn't want you to see the fact that the truth for the dispensation of grace was hidden previously? Every time someone comes along and says, no, that information wasn't just exclusively revealed to Paul, it was there before, they're doing the adversary's bidding. Now, what did I just describe to you? I described to you 99.7% of Christianity. They've been caught in the deception so that they don't embarrass Big Daddy. Follow that? That's something you need to think about. Now, Ephesians chapter 3, verse 10, verse 9, he says, to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which had been, from the beginning of the world, been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ, to the intent that now that it's revealed, under the principalities and powers in heavenly place might be known by the church, the what? Everybody's talking about, let's show the power of God. No, he wants to show his wisdom. You can step out on nothing, create a universe. You are powerful. No question about who the Almighty is. The demons recognize that. The devils recognize that. The unclean spirits recognize that when they talk to Christ. What they don't want you to see is the wisdom of God in that mystery, that hidden wisdom. So what do? They want to come in. Come with me to 1 Timothy. Well, go back to, you're in Ephesians. Just look at chapter 6. How do they work? We've been looking at it. Chapter 6, verse 11. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles, the tricks, the schemes. Scheming strategy. He doesn't come out and say who, what he is. He comes in and tries to deceive you. He wants to make you, move you away. That's why verse 13 talks about being able to stand and you're able to withstand. He wants to come and pressure you away from the truth of God's grace. Chapter 4, verse 14. That we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro. God doesn't want you to be a child in your spiritual life. He wants you to grow up. Verse 15, speaking the truth in love, may grow up unto him. God wants you to grow up into a mature believer, an adult believer, not a child. Now, how do you know when you're a child? Hebrews chapter 5 says, they that use milk, babies, are unskilled in the word of righteousness. Now there's an objective measure that can tell you where you are in your spiritual life. You say, I've been saved 35 years, I've passed tracts, I win souls, I do this, I do that. And you don't know beans with a bag open about God's word. The Bible says you're a baby. You see, it isn't your performing in a religious system that makes you an adult. The church isn't a building and growing, making the church grow isn't performing, isn't running programs in a building. The church is us. And making us grow is the edification process of sound doctrine. Okay? I'm not mad at you. I'm just trying to get the point across. They'll not be tossed to and fro, carried about by every wind of doctrine, by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive. Look at 1 Timothy chapter 4. You want to see those winds of doctrine? You want to see the sleight of men and cunning craftiness whereby they seek to deceive? 1 Timothy 4, now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith. Didn't say they quit believing, said they quit believing the faith. The doctrine that they received through Paul. Giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. That word seducing is important. That word seduce means to draw you away from what's right with a promise of some physical ecstasy and delight. Get you focused on your emotions, your circumstances, your feelings about what's going on, and not the sound doctrine out of God's Word. And as soon as you get seduced away into this emotional experience, then the doctrines taught by, the winds of doctrine taught by the adversary comes along and supports that. And you wind up speaking lies and hypocrisy. Claiming to be one thing, but you're not. Having their conscience seared with a hot iron. We're going to read over there in Ephesians about the fiery darts. When a fire hits flesh, what does it do? It sears it. And those fiery darts of false doctrine come into your soul and they sear it. And they make it pass feeling. They make it frustrated. Have you ever had a piece of scar tissue itch? Is it frustrating or not? It just keeps itching. That's what a seared conscience does. It gives you an itch you can't scratch, you can't satisfy. You get in a panic, manic, frantic search for happiness, for fulfillment. And all of a sudden, the joy of having all of your treasure in Christ is overwhelmed by your emotions, by your feelings. Last Thursday night at the ladies' meeting, Christina gave a message on disappointment. And I was thinking about that. Disappointment. Everybody has disappointment. Somebody said disappointment is when expectations meet reality. And we all have desires, we all have dreams. Whether it's big ones, you know, the job that you want to have, or the family you want to have, or the, God help you, the spouse you want to have, the money, your kids. You have these, and there's always disappointment because you have this expectation up here and reality is down here. And if you don't deal with that disappointment properly, that disappointment will grow into anger because it's the seed of doubt. And doubt, when it's brooded on, becomes discouragement. Discouragement becomes disillusionment. Disillusionment becomes despair. And despair and depression becomes defeat. And it's just an emotional spiral going down. God's Word calls us to live by faith. You see, when you wrestle against flesh and blood, you see it. But when you wrestle against, not against flesh and blood, what are you wrestling against? Thing you can't see. How do you see something you can't see? Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. Faith is the substance of things, the evidence of things not seen. Remember that? And Paul says, we walk by faith, not by sight. And God calls us to walk by faith, to walk beyond our emotions. And when there's something that I'm longing for, more than the treasures that I have in Him, my heart's going to be disappointed. Because the only place you're going to find real fulfillment is in God's grace. We live by grace through faith. That's how you're saved. And you're to walk the same way you're saved. Grace is the issue of realistic expectations. If you expect someone never to fail, if you expect yourself never to fail, that's not realistic. Grace says, you do fail, therefore I provided an answer for you in Christ. So when you have realistic expectations, people are going to fail, I'll fail, they'll fail, but God has provided the answer in Christ. So grace says, here's the realistic expectation. People are sinners and life is in Christ. But it takes faith to bring that into my life. Because the only response grace will accept is faith, but grace requires faith for it to be applied. Faith is depending on the right thing. You have misplaced dependencies. You're depending on your own resources. I was depending on you to do something. I was depending on, and all of a sudden, grace doesn't work because faith is trusting the wrong thing. So what you have is you have realistic expectations and proper dependence. Dependence on what? On God's Word. Faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. And when you have that, your faith rests in an understanding of the treasure that you have in Christ, and you can say, for me to live is Christ. And dying, hey, that just takes all the flesh out of the way. No big deal. But the living is Him. And when I live, you live, we live, treasuring and valuing and cherishing His thinking above our own. In the details of life, not just the big stuff out there, but where I live. That's what we're called to. And that's where the conflict is. Because when he talks about wrestling, he's talking about right there in the nitty-gritty. He's not talking about shooting missiles across, you know, ICBMs or cruise missiles from a battleship and hitting somebody over in the mountains. He's talking about down and dirty in the trenches, hand to hand. That's how you wrestle. There's probably not a more intense form of combat than wrestling. Not wrestling, but wrestling. I'm not talking about Hulk Hogan. I'm talking about the real stuff. And it's our faith resting in who we are and understanding. Listen, you, your family, your friends, your world is under attack by this crowd. Don't take it lightly. I'm just trying to say to you it's real. And when you stand in an intelligent understanding of God's Word and you appropriate it, you know it, what the truth is. You need it. That's what life brings you. And then you reckon it so. You apply it. You'll never apply it and appropriate it in your life if you don't know it. But you can know it forever if you never need it, you're never motivated to take and apply it. But you can know it, need it, and if you don't by faith say, that's who I am and that's how I'm going to operate, it never works. Because that's how God works. It works effectually in you that believe. Now, if you're here this morning and you've never trusted Christ as your Savior, you hadn't got started yet, that's how you get saved. You don't go somewhere. You don't try to perform some religious activity. You don't try to perform some rite. You don't try to make God happy with you because He ain't going to be. Because you come short of the glory of God. But God sent His Son to Calvary and paid for all that's wrong with you so that He can put you in His Son and be happy with you in His Son. And when you trust Jesus Christ to be the Savior that He died and rose again for you to be, God will save you. The Creator will save you. You don't have to have a theological degree. You don't have to even understand it. You just have to trust it, because that's what God's grace does. It gives you what you need, but you don't deserve. And when you get saved, and you are a child of God, you still walk in Him. As you have received Christ Jesus, the Lord, so walk ye in Him. It's still by grace, His provisions, and your faith resting in it. Where the need is in your heart and your life, where the disappointment comes, and all the things that disappointment leads to, look to Calvary. Run to the cross. Rest in that. And appropriate that. And believe, depend on it. And you'll find that it works. That it's life. He that hath the Son hath life. He that hath not the Son of God hath not life. Do you have Him? You have life. Don't have the life and not live the life. Father, we thank You today for life in Christ Jesus. And I just pray these things would be as real in our hearts and minds as You've designed them to be, for Your glory, in Christ's name. Amen.